Sarika, you know me. I love science. And I've been doing everything I can over the last 20 years to change the way that people look at science, because I think it's honestly the best tool we've ever given ourselves for solving really big problems.
Look at that! That's crazy.
I think there are some things you can do to help people think more like scientists in their everyday lives. And so I got a bunch of fun experiments designed to help show us how.
All right, let's see them.
I don't know if I've ever told you this before, but I actually have the magical ability to move metal with my mind. Have I mentioned that before to you? You look skeptical.
I mean,
I can see that you need a demonstration.
Show me.
I'll just put a penny in my palm here, and then I use this sort of magical obelisk to channel the energy, and then I focus and I breathe, and I just.
Okay.
You can move metal with your. You don't look impressed.
I mean, first of all, what is in this little box?
I mean, it's just a magical, there's magical energy.
Magical energy.
Yeah, but okay. It's, you don't seem to believe that.
Okay,
that's
so
what
can
it
I
is.
Have that penny?
Well, there's a bunch of pennies. Grab a penny. You don't believe me, try a penny. But you gotta focus though. So you gotta, are you breathing? Close your eyes, try it again. Mm-hmm. Okay, breathe. Focus, okay, and now move the, are you focusing?
No, because I'm thinking about your penny and I want that penny.
Okay, you think it's the penny? I'll pick a random penny and I'm telling you, it's just about moving the energy with your mind. Now, uh-huh. You try it again. Uh-huh, so Sarika, I feel like you're maybe not focusing.
I'm right not now. Focusing, because I'm trying to figure it out.
So
give me those pennies.
Tell me what you think is going on here.
I don't know what's going on. There's some kind of...
This is, as you suspected, it is a magnet. But for some reason, your pennies weren't reacting to this thing here, right? Like, they weren't reacting to it. Guesses about why that might be the case?
They're not made from the same thing.
Exactly. So my pennies are made after roughly the year 2000, which means that they are made with steel. And as we all know, steel is one of the many metals that are ferromagnetic. In other words, magnetic. So they can actually stick to magnets. But not all metals are actually magnetic. The one you were holding was made out of copper, and copper is not magnetic.
Oh, that's so interesting.
Yeah.
So it used to be that we made pennies out of a different material.
That's right,
and
that's right.
And we suddenly switched.
We made them all out of copper, but we switched because the electronic age started and we started using copper wire in everything.
Oh, wow.
The price of copper skyrocketed through the roof, so we decided we can't be wasting all our money on pennies. So instead, they started making pennies with steel inside of them, which, again, is ferromagnetic. And the cool thing about a ferromagnetic metal is that when it's near a magnet, it turns into a magnet itself, which means that you can actually...
Oh!
Yeah,
look
I know.
At that.
It's pretty awesome. You can stack magnets.
Wow.
And if you're really careful, you can actually lift it up and you can see the shape of that magnetic field. And that's why I love science magic, because it makes people curious about those kinds of things. They want to understand the world around them.
I mean, you're explaining it. You're explaining the science behind it. But it still feels like magic.
Yeah, it absolutely does. So that's my first magic trick. You want to see another one?
Absolutely.
For the next thing, I gotta get a ladder. So just a second.
Hang on. Oh man, a ladder.
Yeah. Okay.
Huh.
So the first thing you want to do to inspire people to think like scientists is to become a magician. But the second thing you want to do is to practice the process.
Oh my, what are you about to do? Why are you so high?
I'm good, don't worry about me. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is I've got a chain of beads, and I'm going to pull them out of the jar, and I want you to watch really closely what happens to the beads at the lip of the jar, okay?
Okay, eyes on the lip.
Eyes on the lip, okay. You ready?
Ready.
3, 2, 1. You see that?
Okay, wow.
Weird.
Okay, it really looked like those beads were jumping by the end.
Exactly, so that is exactly right. The beads are literally jumping out of the jar. I don't know if you've seen something like that before.
I've never seen anything like that.
Okay, so the question is, what is going on there? What would be your guess?
So it seemed like it didn't happen right at the beginning.
Right.
And by the end, it was really jumping.
It was really jumping,
does
right?
Does it have
yeah.
something to do with the weight and gravity?
If the year is 2013, the answer is nobody knows. So I want to put that in context for you. In 2013, we had invented smartphones, we had sequenced the human genome, and we'd gone to the moon, but nobody could explain why beads would jump out of a jar. And so it was left to the internet, just random people on the internet, to try to figure it out. And that's exactly what happened. YouTubers started making videos trying to explain their own theories of how this was happening. They were talking to physicists at universities, and eventually we figured it out. They realized that if you look at the way the beads bend, there's a limit to how much they can kind of fold around themselves. And so because of that limit, the beads start acting kind of like a seesaw. Imagine tying a rope to one end and yanking it up as hard as you can. What happens to the other end? It slams into the ground, of course. And because every action has an equal and opposite reaction, the ground pushes up with just as much force. The chain does that 1,000 times in a row. And all those forces add up together to push it higher and higher out of the pot.
So is that why by the end of that string of beads, the arc was higher?
Exactly. So they figured out that the higher you could hold the jar and the longer the beads could fall, those are all factors that would increase the height of the jump.
That's amazing. This question was kind of put out there and then almost like citizen scientists started doing it in their own homes.
And that is exactly why I love practicing the process with people. The idea that we have a question we don't know the answer to, and we don't pretend that we know, we get to do the fun of exploring science.
Well, that's the best part of science,
right?
Exactly. All of us have these ideas, we put them into a body of water, we're all adding, and then somewhere in that mix, we come up with solutions.
Exactly. So that was my second experiment, but my favorite one is the last one. But we can't do it in here. You got your coat?
There's another one?
There's another one. Yeah. Get your coat. Go get your coat. I'm gonna get my coat.
What the?
Okay. Okay.
Okay, Anthony, why did you bring me up here and why are we putting on all this safety equipment?
Yeah, good question, Sarika. We're gonna do something pretty unusual. We're gonna try to walk inside a cloud.
What? Walk in a cloud?
Well, the thing that I love about science is that if you understand it, you can do some really incredible things. So that's what we're gonna try to do.
Why do I feel really nervous? What is that coming out of there?
This is liquid nitrogen. It's about negative 196 degrees. It is very, very cold, dangerous to touch. I got like 35 liters of this stuff.
Yeah, why do you have so much of it? What are you doing right now?
Well, we're standing right now in like an ocean of air, all right? There's water in that air too, and I wanna be able to see that water, so you're gonna help me.
Okay.
I'm gonna grab this and this. You're gonna take this. These are filled with hot water.
Yes.
And I'm gonna try to basically squeeze all the water out of the air. You're gonna help me. We're gonna, on the count of three, we're gonna dump these into the liquid nitrogen.
Okay.
And see how it goes.
This is how much I trust you, Anthony.
You trust me?
No idea what's about to happen.
Okay.
Okay, you gonna count us down?
I'm gonna count us down. Three, two, one. Wow!
Oh my god!
That was amazing!
Okay.
That was so cool!
You could have warned me a little bit!
Oh, I told you we were gonna walk in a cloud. We walked in a cloud. Oh my god, it was awesome! It was awesome! All right, I got so excited here that I kind of forgot to explain what happened, so first, we get clouds anytime air with lots of water vapor in it cools. Liquid nitrogen is negative 196 degrees Celsius, so 10 liters of it is more than enough to cool a lot of air. Throwing the hot water in it boils the liquid nitrogen so quickly that we get an explosive expansion of it up into the air. You can even hear it. All that nitrogen in the air condensed the water vapor, and we get this incredible mushroom cloud. You're welcome, Sarika.
So you made a cloud.
I made a cloud.
Level.
Yeah, you helped me. You made a cloud.
I don't know.
If you understand science, you can do amazing things.
Okay, I understand science. I was not expecting that. I don't know if I forgive you.
Thank you, Sarika. Thank you for trusting me.
Uh-huh.
And thank you for watching.
Thanks for watching.
Three, two, one. Wow!
Oh my god!
That was amazing!
Okay.
That was so cool!
You could have warned me a little bit!
Oh, that was awesome! Oh, I want to do it again!
You want to
try it again?
Right? That is pretty cool, I have to say.
That was pretty cool.